Today's program has been brought to you by TechServe, New York's original and still the best Apple computer, iPod, and iPhone store and repair shop. For more information, visit TechServe.com. You're listening to Heritage Radio Network, broadcasting live from Bushwick, Brooklyn. If you like this program, visit heritageradionetwork.org for thousands more.
We talk about food, we talk about music, with musical dudes, finger on the pulse, Snacky Tunes.
All the shit, we fucking around.
Talking, all of y'all be listening. So MC Top is stalking. Now all of y'all be pissing. All in all, I ain't fancy. Tearing up pink panties. Balling out in my man skin. Smashing up them banshees. Small money like spray cheese. Man, please. MC TODD. Ready for that heady scene. Tripping off this window pane. Acid got me seeing things a whole lot differently. Simply, exquisitely. Lights bright for eternity. Tripping brother fraternity. I cop blotter, certainly. Got no other priority.
Ma, you disappointed in me?
MC Todd loves drugs and breasts. That's right. Drugs and breasts.
I don't care what people do. I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my
dues. That's right.
I don't care what people do. I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my
dues. That's right. Beer bones and rap songs. Two blondes and two thongs. Getting their groove on. Switching dicks like ping pong. Now I'm aping like King Kong. Pants off but flip-flops on. Never know when I get gone. Boyfriend calling no one home. I'm tossing that cell phone. I'm still bone. Dicks off and she's still blowing. Whipped cream and chocolate flowing. Dicks off and she's still blowing. Whipped cream and chocolate flowing. Nitrous and Jenga. Three bodies all tangled. Climbing me like a flagpole. Half mass, ass fag. Cat like reaction. Pass that green grass. Roll it up with that earwax. Smoke it up, go to work. Smash it up, girl, you need a job. It's a job, kicking balls.
I don't care what
all of y'all.
I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my pay. I don't care what people do. I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my way.
Low life, a dirt bag. Got me miles ahead. Got me plenty of head. Back up on that wall. Dirty chicks in bathroom stalls. Dirty chicks get dick, y'all. Haters up on my shit, y'all. Throat's about to get slit, y'all. Fancy things, that's how I roll. Cop new Jordans for more. Gold teeth don't hold heat, but I got dudes that watch me. Flossin', never offbeat. Noshin' on lunch meat. Moshin' to back street. Black hoodies and pants be made out of that sweat steam. Me and your girl be best. BFF like best friends. I'll be resting these testes. Bouncing in, bouncing out. In her mouth, never pulling out. Bitch so loud, got dick in her mouth. Shit talking now.
I don't care what people do. I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my
dues. That's right.
I don't care what people do. I don't care what people say. Always try to get my dues. Always try to get my
dues. That's right.
Yeah, and then I like take that face, I just grab it by that side ponytail, you know what I'm saying? I just like pull that hair right down into my balls, you know what I'm saying? Just smash that shit, just smash that shit. Watch that shit, my balls coming out of ears and shit, you know what I'm saying? Just pulling that hair, you know what I'm saying? Just tongue all out, licking on my balls, all deep in that shit, deep in that motherfucking mouth cavity, you know what I'm saying? Just
welcome to Snacky Tunes. We're going to fade on out on that one. I mean, it's the internet. It's the internet, but I think we have a little bit of, I don't know. There's really no threshold. That was just MC Todd with the, is it the first track? Chicago?
Chicago. It's not the first track. It's like
the first track of my Dropbox.
It's the first track.
It's the first track.
I'm like super digitally inept. So like, you know, like your brother was like, hey man, when you send things out, you should like make sure that it's packaged the way it's supposed to be.
Oh, yeah.
All it should be right.
Well, you're talking.
And I was like, I had no idea how to do it. And then you guys asked me for it. And I was like, here.
You're talking to one of the masters of digital packaging.
Is he a master?
He's really good at that stuff.
Wow. He should have helped me out. He should have at least like gave me some advice afterwards.
Didn't you just explain to us that he gave you some advice?
Yeah, that was earlier. I forgot, man. Come on.
Well, MC Todd's going to be hanging out all day. He's going to be performing live in studio. We're very excited about. He's drinking coffee and beer.
At the same time.
But first up, we have Pat Fondiller. Did I get that?
Fondiller.
Oh.
Yeah, Fondiller. You know.
No. Pat Fondiller.
Whatever works.
Did you make it Fondiller and it was Fondiller and you were like, fuck this shit, I ain't doing
it. It's like,
this.
We can't have our family name for what we've done in the past. who is from Somebody Knows Brewery. Talk to me about what you do. What's your roles over at the brewery?
I'm a salesman for the brewery. I work out in New York City. I cover a lot of markets for the brewery. I cover mostly, you know, my main market is New York City. You know, then Westchester, Rockland counties, like upstate and New Jersey, northern Jersey. But I also...
It's a pretty easy beer to sell, correct?
It is. It's very, very easy.
So for those who don't know Smutty Nose, what is the overall flavor profile of Smutty Nose? What type of beer do you guys produce?
We do... Our biggest selling brand by far is called Finest Kind IPA.
Mm.
It accounts for about 50% of what we make at the brewery. It's a very highly rated IPA, and as Todd was saying, it's very easy to sell. We've been in New York for going about 10 years now, and I took over for these guys about 3 years ago, and find that going out and getting into places that haven't had it on for a while, they have a very good memory of the beer, and it's easy to place.
You have one of those awesome jobs, right? Where you
it doesn't suck.
Though. It doesn't. Where you roll up and you got beer and you get to knock a few back with everybody.
Yeah, exactly. So, buy people beer. Everybody loves it.
It's not like you're selling like vacuums. You're not like rolling and being like, hey, I got some useless crap for you. You're like, hey, you want to try some beer you might want to buy.
Yeah, you generally don't walk in and say, I have beer for you and get a negative reaction.
People go like, not in this bar, sir.
Not interested.
Actually, if there was any city where there might be bartenders like at a wine bar or something like that who would be snooty, it would be New York.
Yeah
or San Francisco.
I mean, even there I don't find it, you know.
No.
It's just
you spent time in San Francisco. You've been into the craft beer thing since like the 80s, right?
I've been in it for a long time. I actually lived in San Francisco for several years.
What was that like? How'd you like the West Coast?
I liked it there. I mean, I really did. I was there for longer than most people that go out there and stay there, but
I was born there.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that's where I got into the beer thing. But after a while, after about 6 or 7 years, I started to really miss the New York City.
And
I wanted to come back.
Air that didn't smell like patchouli.
Yeah. Exactly. It's a different culture out there.
It's a little crunchy. Yeah. It's a little crunchy, no doubt.
I mean, Hit Ashbury is still crunchy and
it's
weird.
It's very the whole all of San Francisco is still very crunchy. The whole scene is very
yeah. It's definitely. I would say it's way different than, like, if you know, people always want to compare L.A. and New York. I say L.A. is more like New York than San Francisco. Like, San Francisco is
most definitely
totally different.
Most you know, definitely. It's fun. I get back there from time to time, and it's like the old cliche. It's not, it's nice to visit there. But
beautiful to visit. And
they're very in touch with the earth, though. Yeah. You know, it's like, how in touch with the earth do you want to be for how long?
Right. And is that where you really fell in love with craft beer?
It is, really, yeah.
It's funny, because I feel like San Francisco, I mean, they have Speakeasy and some other places that I don't really think of San Francisco as.
Well,
like,
back in those days, I mean, most of these places weren't even around. I mean, you had like my first introduction to craft beer was Sierra, and it was literally it's actually a funny story. I was in a bar in San Francisco, and I had a guy come up to me and was just like incessantly mocking me for drinking Budweiser. I mean, you know, some
that sounds
local.
Like San Francisco.
Yeah, and finally, like, to the point where I wanted to take him outside and like, you know, yeah, have it out with him.
Show
and
him what
he
a guy from the East Coast
left because he could tell that he was agitating me, and then he came back and he put a pint of Sierra Pale Ale in front of me, and he was like, "Drink this," and I drank it and had an instant epiphany. Really,
was that one of those things? This is before Sierra was what it is now.
It's not. Sierra has maintained a pretty consistent quality of
their
beer.
They have like some continuity in their product. I think.
I mean, as far as like brand recognition. Like, had you not heard of Sierra before you had that first sip?
No, I mean, they.
Well, how many years ago?
I had heard about it, obviously, but they had, you know, they've been around since the late 70s.
And they made a really quick come up marketing wise, like in the.
It's a good beer.
You know, early 90s, I think.
They're a very, very big company now, but the quality of their beer is still as good as it was.
Do you feel the same way about Samuel Adams?
No, I don't.
Man, Sam Adams is
because they pose themselves as
it's the beer brand that like beer lovers love to hate.
You know, I have a great deal of respect for Jim Cook, and without him, we wouldn't be sitting here right now. I mean,
that's what everyone
really
says.
He's really one of the pioneers.
However,
they, unlike Sierra, I don't feel like the Boston Lager has maintained the same quality that it had at the beginning.
Right, like they cut some corners at some point to make the margins work for them fiscally.
There's that famous New York article with the head of Dogfish Brewery who was talking about how people have respect for the consistency of like the Budweiser. Of how every can tastes the same and how tough that is.
It is not easy. And in fact, when these guys come out of when they come out of brew school, like if it's UC Davis, you know, these guys take all the best brewers. They take all the, you know, all the top brewers because precisely for that, it's not easy.
It's a very difficult job. I mean, they're more like heart surgeons than they are like artists.
Right.
You know,
right.
There's different style. Like when you start manufacturing something at a large scale, you have to like obviously consistency and continuity is the greatest difficulty. So you really have to be very, very good at what you do to create something for that many people.
Right.
Yeah, that's good. So enough about other breweries. Let's talk about Smutty Nose. So what was the start? How did they found their
beginnings? Will be we're going on our 20th year now. So actually next year will be our 20th year. We're in the process of building a brand new brewery in Hampton, which is a town next to Portsmouth. It's going to be a total LEED certified brewery. Our capacity will, when we open the door, will probably be about 60,000 barrels a year, and we're on a 14-acre farm called Toll Farm, and you know, they're cruising along on the project, and we're really excited, you know, to get into the new place.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And is the beer just getting into, how many markets are you in now?
We are in 20 states, I believe, off the top of my head. It's not a secret anymore, but we're going to open Kentucky next.
Okay.
We have no plans at the current time to go past the Mississippi, although we have one wholesaler in Milwaukee, one very small wholesaler.
Do they drink beer in Milwaukee?
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Do different regions drink different beers?
Of course.
Oh, yeah.
Of course.
Yeah.
So give us a few, who drinks what where?
Well, let's say Cleveland is, you know, Great Lakes Brewery does about 100,000 barrels a year. I'd say most of that is sold in Cleveland itself.
Right. You can find a regional beer in any region you go to. You could say this beer kind of exists in this region and only in this region.
Yeah, and that's kind of, you know, our ownership, like Peter Eggleston and Joanne Francis, and you know, Peter's ideal is to just have a regional brewery. He doesn't want Smutty Nose to be a national brewery.
Right.
He wants to remain somewhat small and, you know, take care of the.
Does that make your job harder when you're trying to sell as much beer as possible?
Not particularly, man. I mean, we right now are making as much beer as we can sell. So,
and I hate to use the word demographic, but it actually helps you when you have a narrower region because you actually understand what your customer base is, and like you have a relationship with them, and you understand how to sell to them. I mean, this is just corporate type. Like understanding that, like once you narrow it down to a region, you can kind of be like, I know what these people want. It's much easier to sell than to like broaden your horizon and kind of be like, now I got to take it to New Orleans where there's a different climate and there's different likes and dislikes.
Yeah,
and
different tastes. Or for instance, if we were to go to the West Coast, like if we were to go to California where I came from originally, it would make a big splash. I mean, you know, I've been out there before and had representatives from wholesalers come up to me and freak out about Smutty Nose. But if we went there, it would be a flash for 6 months,
right,
and then everybody would forget about it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think we're looking at maybe we've been exporting a small amount of beer to England for a while, and I think we're gonna start looking that way.
Do you feel as like a common beverage and food theme that people are kind of a little bit like more inclined to like things that are from closer to where they are, like regional things?
I think you see a lot of that.
They like I mean, I know chefs, you know, they tend to shop. But you know, buy their stuff closer to where they are.
I think things
that
can ship like a beer or something like that, people are willing to hunt it out. Like Pappy Van Winkle is a perfect example of like a liquor.
You can't find that right now.
You can't find it right now.
But when you start talking about spirits, there's no like expiration date on it. When you start talking about beer, it still has like a type of
freshness
that you need, and you want to have the beer out and sold as fast as you can get it out of the barrels. So
I think there's like a local pride too. We sell most of our beer in New Hampshire still, you know.
Right.
Where the brewery is, and there's like, you know, there's a big like local
pride. There's some camaraderie that comes from
that. Do you like Harpoon?
I like some of the beer they make.
Winter Warmer is one of my favorites.
Yeah, I mean, I love their Leviathan series. Yeah. I think they make a lot of really good beers, and you know, I know all the. I was a buyer for a place called The Gate in Park Slope for years, and I developed a lot of relationships with the people from various breweries. But you know, Harpoon is a big competitor of ours because you know,
yeah,
Boston's
our big market.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. All right, well, we're going to take a short break. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about the Beer, Bourbon, and Barbecue Festival that's happening on January 26th, which is going to be awesome. We'll be right back. Here we go, Snacky Tunes. Little more Brooklyn, New York, hip-hop, Beastie Boys, Sure Shot.
And you don't stop, or when you can't.
Yes, indeed, it's fun time, fun time.
The seat.
Well, I'm that kid in the
Oh my God, that song never gets old. Little flute.
I can go Beastie Boys all the time.
Yeah.
I just.
It's like a dessert.
Yeah. So we got into the beer. That's exactly what happened. We're drinking the. We're drinking the porter. Why don't you tell us about this porter? Because this is the porter.
Delicious.
It's the robust porter, it's what you want out of a porter, I think. Because so many times it's just sweet and heavy, and you go, why are people into this drink?
Yeah, this is one of the beers that we make that people just go gaga over. This is the American Craft Brewers Guild, a quintessential example of the style of beer. It's on their poster. This beer has won everything. It was won GABF Gold, Mundial twice. It's won the Good Food Awards out in San Francisco. Alice Waters thing.
And it's going.
It's the best porter years. I've had.
And I'll put it this
most
way.
Most porters hurt my teeth. I think I have mini cavities that aren't filled, and every time I drink porter, it kind of makes my mouth hurt.
And I do appreciate it that you paired it with my cornmeal pancakes. So coming up on the 26th. We have the 4th annual Beer, Bourbon, and Barbecue Festival, which I only found about last year because I was gallery hopping in Chelsea.
No,
and then I saw
right over there.
I saw a couple of smokers, and I was with this girl I was dating at the time, and I was like,
"Wait, is that like slang for like hot chicks?"
Yeah. I like stopped, and I was like, "Hey, what's a smoker doing here in Chelsea?" And I was like, "Wait, there's 3 of them." And then I just sort of went over and I was like, hey, I'm from Heritage. Can I come in and check this event out? And it was just all the beer you could drink, all the bourbon you could drink, and all the barbie you could eat. The lines are pretty long, though.
And cigars, too.
And cigars. Yeah. I don't smoke cigars.
Do you ever fear that you're going to get sued for like somebody getting gout?
There was definitely some people at the end who had to get carried out. And the trail out was messy.
That's what you get when you add bourbon rather to the equation. I've been to a million of these things, obviously, over the course of the last decade, but this one is a particularly good party.
It sounds good. I'd never be able to tell by the size of your beard that you've been to this party before.
So wait, so tell us about the event if you've never been.
I was there last year for the first time, I thought it was fantastic. I like the fact that there aren't. You know, that they have all of the really great bourbon makers. They have seminars where these guys will come and speak. I'm actually going to be doing a speaking engagement. We're bringing a cask of our Imperial IPA called Big A, and they're going to put me in a room where I'm going to talk about four of the beers that we have. They don't overload it like a lot of these things you go to. There's like a million brands, but with the beer at this one, there's not that. You know, there's not a billion. There's concentrated, kind of focus.
And
do they curate this in a specific way though? Are they like looking for something specifically?
I would say I was really impressed. I mean, it's essentially every micro batch bourbon that you can think of, plus the heavy hitters. And then as far as the beers go, it's really good. I mean, it's for people who love this type of food and drink. Like, it's not just, oh, hey, we have, you know, Budweiser and Rub Barbecue, who I can say because I shut down.
Right. But right. I think you do.
Are you talking to me specifically? You are looking directly at me.
No, like, but I'm just saying it's
this asshole.
No, but, you know, it's curated.
Yeah, it is. And I think you get, you know, especially being in New York City, you get a high concentration of people that are there that are very serious. They're tasting this stuff to buy it for their restaurants, for their bars. But of course, you'll always get the element of the people that are just there to get hammered.
There are definitely some chinos and button down blue shirts.
And by the end of it, you'll definitely see the effects of that.
It really is the bourbon. Because they're, you know. It's a lot. You know, you just go and taste like 6 or 7 bourbons and go, oh, wait a second, hold on. No one's spitting out.
You see some people walking out of their sideways, you know.
I saw some people passed out.
So where is this?
It's on the corner of 11th and 28th in West Chelsea. There's a Bacon Bash tasting session from noon to 4. It's in 2 segments. There's the noon to 4, then the 5:30 to 9. And then there's a whole hog at night.
Right. I think that the first session is focused on the bacon, like you were saying. The second one is the whole hog picking session.
And do you feel like that you get a lot of restaurant people, mostly like industry kind of people, or do you think you got a fair?
I think you get a fair amount of people that are just there for the curiosity.
Right.
You know, just there to party. But yeah, I do think that there are a large number of people that are in the industry.
It's definitely got enough good people there that if you go with the intent to buy and to taste and to meet people, especially if you're a new restaurant or something like that. But it's all good. It's so
finally
good.
Something else getting cut up at the tunnel, not people.
Yes. Or lines.
Or lines. True that.
Well, I want to thank you, Pat, for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me.
Thank you for the beer. What's the website, Twitter, Facebook? Where can people go tour the brewery?
We do tours on Saturday. If you go to smuttynose.com, you can get all the information that you want. There are tabs up there for beers. For the tour, just basically get all the information you need for anything.
That's awesome. Yeah. And the website again is Smutty Nose?
www.smuttynose.com.
Is our Twitter, Instagram?
I believe all the handles are Smutty Nose.
Yeah, that's pretty Googleable.
Lucky.
Yeah, exactly.
Lucky.
And we also, I have a Facebook page here in New York called Smutty Nose NYC Chapter.
Cool.
And is that for like meetups and...
Yeah. If you get on that, you'll get all the information about where we're going to be, like in New York doing our thing.
Well, I would recommend it. Well, Pat, thank you so much.
Yeah, cheers. Thank you.
We got MC Todd coming up next. A little bit more just Brooklyn hip hop, and we'll get right back to it here on Snacky Tunes.
Hello, can I speak to you know who you are. Look, you had no idea what you're dealing with. Something on something is real as shit. Pop champagne, I give you a sip. About to go dumb, how come? Yeah, that's my bitch. That's my bitch. Shorty right there, that's my bitch. That's my bitch. Get your own. It ain't safe in the city, watch the throne. She said, I care more about them Basquions. Basquiat, she learning a new word is shot. Blew the world up soon as I hit the club with her. Too short call, told me I fell in love with her. See by actors, ball players, and drug dealers. And some lesbians that never love niggas. Twisted love story, true romance. Mary Magdalene from a pole dance. I'm a freak, huh? Rockstar life. The second girl with us, that's our wife. Hey, boys and girls, I got a new riddle. Who's a new old perv that's trying to play second fiddle? No disrespect, I'm not trying to be little. With my dick worth money, I put money in the middle. Where she at? In the middle.
A nigga for a nigga, go figure. Homie, keep my own money if we ever did split up. I got some so gangsta, piece of pretty in pictures. Red jeans and a blazer and some Louis Vuitton slippers. Picasso was alive, he would've made her. That's right, nigga, Mona Lisa can't fade her. I mean, Marilyn Monroe, she's quite nice. But why all the pretty icons always all white? Put some color girls in the MoMA. Half these bras ain't got nothing on Madonna. Don't make me bring Thelma in it. Bring Helly, bring Penelope or Selma in it. Back to my Beyonce's. You deserve 3 stacks for the entree. Call Larry Gagosian. You belong in museums. You belong in vintage clothes. Crushing the whole building. You belong with niggas who used to be known for dope dealing. You're too dope for any of those civilians. Now shoot your just stop looking at a tits. Get your own dog, get her. That's my bitch. We'll be right back.
displacement. Catching fire in here, I'm top gear. Best in class, clear as glass. That's why I got you wet and reckless, shaking all that ass. I ain't sexist, I'm just real. Breaking down the dance floor, foot loose and shiny grill. Girl, how you feel? I get loose like Candyman knocking boots. You came in face smashing fruits. Who is you? I do as I do. You're funny like mythical creatures locked in a zoo. I'm like 10 dice in a fight for smash. Been right behind that banging ass. Faking mergers and acquisitions. Put myself in perfect position. Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man. First two coming through, beer boy, mouth full of chew. Ain't got a script to eat this shit, but I got enough to sneak this shit. Peel popping, drug copping, fleece rocking, white boy. That's right, twat, wind up motor that's steel. Broke you dumb, boy, you still a joke. Stealing a girl, stealing a coke. Sit next to me, make you look broke. Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose, knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose, knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man.
I get loose, knocking boots.
Get a little bit of head, man.
Yeah, that was just Get Low by MC Todd. Welcome. Man, Pat was, there was so much more we could have talked to him about.
He's amazing.
He's he was telling us about, you know, he plays in no wave bands.
Yeah.
He's got that look. He's got that old metal dude look, though.
He does. He looks like a dude that I've seen at a Neurosis show.
He's really...
I wish he would have left a bottle opener so we could have drank the rest of this beer.
I don't know. Joe, are there any more bottles openers out there?
Yeah. Yeah, or Joe, you're a producer, Joe. Man. You should be able to like figure out how to do this with like your boot or something.
Joe's coming in. Well, we want to welcome to the show officially again, MC Todd. Who?
Thank you.
It's been a long time in the making.
About 40 years, almost. 40 near.
40 years. Well, cheers. Here, we'll do this.
Thank you. Oh yeah.
Yes, money knows. MLK Day.
We've been together for a long time, man.
Yeah, we go back 6 years?
Maybe
7 years?
I would say longer than that because Roberta's is having its 5th year anniversary.
Are you actually going to do a party this year?
We're going to tie it together with a tiki disco.
Okay.
So the first tiki disco is also going to be our 5th year anniversary party.
Oh, you don't want to do
it
another?
It was January 11th was the day.
Yeah. Oh, so it's happened.
It already happened, yeah.
But remember how last year's was not... Remember a lot of jerks showed up.
Yeah. I think there was a couple fights.
But yes,
fights broke out.
We go way back to the Benchy days.
Yeah, the Royal Oak. You guys threw a party one Friday every month while I... Two Fridays every month while I bartend. Finger on the Pulse, which I believe is in the theme song of your opener.
Yes,
for
it
this.
Is. Shout out to Wallpaper for that.
Yeah, man.
But enough about us. Let's talk about MC Todd. So when were you born? When did you pop out of the rap?
When was the rapper MC Todd born?
Yeah.
I would say probably like, 4 years ago. I think it lived inside of me for a really long time. I mean, you know me. I'm a musical dude.
Yeah.
I played in bands. You know, I've always been into hip hop since, you know, the early 90s. Actually, since I was a little kid, I've always... had a great admiration for hip hop and a collector. I've like followed seriously, even when I was playing in metal bands and rock bands. I was always into hip hop, but like 4 years ago, I started doing MC Todd, which Todd is my middle name, which was a character kind of myself, like in the inner me of me. And I was doing these kind of promo things for Roberta's, where I was like, the like real dude inside of me was like being like, yo, this is everything at Roberta's, man. Beer bongs, titties. And I was like, you know, it's kind of funny, but really it's the like dude who lives inside of me all of the time.
I mean, that's how I feel how people get to do what they want to do. They start with comedy mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden you go, no, this is for real.
I've always wanted to do comedy. So like this definitely started in the comedical like sense. And then really as it developed, I realized I could rap. And I think people around me started being like, yo, man, like this is not just like you're not joking. Like as long as you're not joking, this isn't a joke.
Yeah.
And then I kind of started to take it seriously. And it's like it does like it represents like what dudes like me would like to say to the world sometimes. And like I feel like I get to say some things as a rapper that like maybe typically white dudes like me don't get to say all the time.
Yes. I think there are some things that as a white dude rapper. you don't always get to say.
Yeah. Or, well, at least, like, not taken seriously and taken seriously at the same time by people that aren't taking you seriously.
So have you noticed a shift now that you've taken yourself more seriously, that people take you more seriously?
Absolutely not. Nobody takes me serious. The people are like, who the fuck is this dude over here with the gold teeth? It's kind of, man, I understand. If I saw myself from afar, I'd be like, this guy's totally ridiculous. But at the same time, man, it's like I'm putting myself out there to be like criticized, and like, but I'm like really truly like trying to attack an art form that I think I'm good at, and like I'm putting stuff out into the world that I really think is good.
Well, if no one knew that you were MC Todd, I think they would be surprised about how good the rap is, if that makes any sense.
It makes sense to me, because I hear people say this often, because looking at me, you might be like, no, this dude can't rap. Like, if I saw me, actually, most times when I see myself in the mirror, I'm like, this guy can't rap.
Do you practice rapping in front of the mirror?
I do.
To get your face down?
Not really. I feel like I got naturally have good rap face, because, you know, I played it. I got like good guitar face, and my bass face really kills it. Like, you should see my funk face. It's like, it makes girls wet. Seriously.
Yes.
It's like a really funky.
What bass know, face?
My bass face. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Well, speaking of, let me see that rap face. Let's hear a song.
Okay.
What are we going to hear first?
I think we should do You Don't Know Me, which is kind of like the single. It'll be my first video. My album is coming out February 12th. It's my debut album. It's called Damn Near 40 Years in the Making. And this is kind of like the title track off that.
All right, here we go. MC Todd live on Snacky Tunes.
You might have to turn me up a little bit, man, because it's weird when it's quiet. You my producer, Joe, or you against me? All right, I guess you ain't doing shit. Yeah. Here I go, with the flow, beer down to the flow. Lightning right behind me, tripping, sipping, sounds a go. Open up a door to a room I ain't seen before. Multiple dimensional, LSD detention, bro. Lights out, lights on, black light on neon. Tricky, sticky in my bong, all these pills already gone. All these girls up in them thong, irking, twerking, get it on. Hit the flow, get some more, comically all Comic-Con. Got my Nikes on, my Vans on me. Pound this pussy up and down, homie. Got this carpet in my van, homie. Exercise a stripper's hand, homie. Rhyme two, going down. I be knocking dudes around in the paint, getting drunk, fade away, throw it up. Low post, posting up. Girls be working right out front. Skirt to pump, skirt to pump. To get it up, get it up. All these girls were born to fuck. I was born in a storm. Mama's womb was warm as fuck. Ride the lightning, thunderstruck. Devil made me who I was when I was, when I was drunk. Always wanna run amok. Red, white, and blue, I bleed that stuff. Got my Nikes on, my Vans on me. Pound this pussy up and down, homie. Got this carpet on my van, homie. Yeah. Sitting on the lawn, all fucked up, already gone. All King Kong, pounding on this sweet young thing. They love that John. I ain't scared, never was. 6'1", hairy as fuck. Run my name right through the mud. Drown my pain in angel blood. Ain't that dumb, 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 dumb. So flow, so slow. So high, so high, about the ozone. Switch, no miss, this ain't D-Wade. I'll be Kobe all damn day. Make my money, I'll get paid. You'll be right behind me, boy, jumping on a hand grenade. So damn bone stone, vaporized lung zone. 10 top 10, got me Snake and Axl Rose, homie. Got my Nikes on, my Vans on me. Pound this pussy up and down, homie. Got this carpet in my van, homie. Exercise a stripper's hand, homie. Yeah. MC Todd. Yeah.
What?
MC Todd.
Got me saying.
MC Todd. It's a really shitty name, I know that.
Say it again.
I understand. It's a really shitty name. But it's my name.
Say it again.
I am an MC too. I am the master of most ceremonies. The ceremonies that I'm the master of are pretty lame, but I'm still the master. MC Todd.
Awesome. Great rap face.
Thanks, man. I also closed my eyes the whole time I rapped that time. I've never done that before, but I was it was like multiple dimensional.
I did like how with your eyes closed, you reach for the beer, hit the coffee, and like, no, I want the beer.
Yeah, no, I knew. I was like, that's paper.
That's paper.
I'm looking for glass, no doubt.
Oh my God, that T-shirt.
Yeah, I got you a T-shirt. I bought your brother one too.
Awesome.
I didn't know he wasn't gonna be here. I kind of knew he wouldn't be here because he doesn't like me.
No, that's not true. That's awesome. So I think I heard in the lyrics a reference to pumps, and there is an infamous article from Vice where you go to pumps.
Is it infamous? Is it really infamy that it is, or is it slightly cultly not liked?
Is it not liked?
I don't think anyone actually looked at it. There's only like 6 comments on the whole article. I think you and like maybe 9 other people saw it.
What was that like?
Doing an interview for Vice?
Or going to a strip club with them? I mean...
All right. So this is what went down. So Kelly McClure from Vice asked if I would do an interview with Vice. And at that point, I didn't really understand what MC Todd was. So, like,
right.
I had no idea. I was just, like, making rap songs, and I really just didn't understand what it was. I own a restaurant. I have, like, a real job that I put a lot of effort into all the time. So it was just kind of this thing that existed, like, outside of my world. And I didn't really – there was no, like, persona. There was nothing for her to ask questions about because I had never put out any songs. I'd never really done anything. It was just the idea of MC Todd. So I was like, what am I going to – like, she's going to interview me and I'm going to have nothing to say, which I didn't. She interviewed me and I didn't. So, like, I kind of felt like I would, like, lighten up the mood by, like – I took a bunch of acid and I told her to meet me at Pumps, and like she couldn't do it. So she sent like a younger like writer from Vice, Sasha Heck, who was amazing. Awesome. Like she was like, OK, cool. I'm going to come meet you at Pumps. And I was faced like I was fucked up on acid, and like being on acid in a strip club that's like filled with neon lights and motorcycles hanging from the ceiling.
And especially Pumps.
Especially Pumps, because it's like my strip club too. It's like the strip club I go to on the regular.
Are you on the reg there?
Pretty much. You know, when the bartenders know your name, you feel like you've probably gone to the strip club maybe a little too much.
You put some of the strippers' kids through
college?
I'll
tell you this. If I could take back some of that money, I'd probably have like a Maserati or some kind of fancy Italian car.
You know... We had a bachelor party for our cousin there at Pumps, and it's amazing what you can get for like $173.
It's truly amazing.
Truly amazing.
Truly amazing. So think of what
they ran out of things to do.
Yo, one time I spent like $200.
Oh yeah,
balled out. Should have seen that.
You were there for like a week.
It was wild.
You got a room.
I could have been there for a week.
Room, a steak.
They got a recording facility upstairs.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure about that. I'm going to do my next album at
That's
Pumps.
A great record live at Pumps.
Duh.
MC Todd, the second album.
Yeah, no doubt. My second album's going to be called Retarded.
With like the Boston people spell it? Like a T-A-H?
Retarded. Like my last name.
Oh, like retarded.
Todd. Like re-todded.
I love that.
Yeah.
I'm a big fan of puns.
Yeah.
So no,
that was not a pun. That's a reality.
A reality? So what's MC Todd like in the kitchen? What's your cooking style?
Like crock pot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Slow and low.
Yeah, like I like to use Coca-Cola to cook everything. You know what I'm
like
saying?
Like a Coca-Cola pork sauce
of thing? I like beef, you know, like a braised beef with Coca-Cola.
Sort of like a Korean barbecue type of stuff?
Nah, man, you know, I got mad style. I got all types of different shit in the kitchen. You know, I go all over the place.
All over the map?
You might catch me making pho. You might catch me making meatballs. I don't know. I got like a sweet gumbo. You know,
and is that stuff that you also have on your rider?
No, my rider is pretty basic, to be honest with you, because most people won't let me even play shows. So like by the time I get there, I'm pretty much like, you got a microphone? And they're like, yeah. And I'm like, cool, you just fulfilled the rider.
Yeah, one microphone.
That's it. And one like input. Maybe a place for my DJ to stand, because I'm not going to use them. I'm just going to plug my phone into the PA system.
Who did the beats for you? They're pretty good.
Yeah, no, so that's my really boys. Good. Yeah, like dudes that I've known for a while, Alex Eagleton and his cousin Chris, the Rec Kids. They're like dudes I knew from the Royal Oak days. Like,
oh, yeah.
Actually, Alex was a bartender back in the day, and like we'd just been friends, and nobody really wanted to put out my out, like nobody wanted to help me with it, because everyone was like, yo, you stupid, man, like this is really stupid shit that you're doing. And like Jack tried to help me a little bit, and he was like, he made like Jack the producer here, he yeah. tried to make some songs for me, and he was just like, man, I ain't got time for this shit, I got a real job. Like, I just can't, like, you know, I can't be wasting my time with this shit. And like kind of everyone's attitude was the same way towards it. It was like, yo man, you joking, this is stupid, like, so don't do it. But you know, I just was like, fuck that, I'm gonna do it no matter what. And these dudes like kind of were like, yo, we'll do it for you. So that's how I wound up with them. They killed it on the
they
production side of it.
You that know? Production, it does not sound like bedroom producing at all. It sounds...
Yeah, yeah. And all my shit was like real rough, man. Like I have hundreds and hundreds of songs. They're just like,
so
they're sketches. They're like,
if
they're
you
like garage band
tomorrow,
shit.
You could put out albums for next few years.
Dude, for reals. Like if somebody was like, yo, man, I got some money, I want to put out your shit, like catch me. Yo, my Twitter handle's The Real MC Todd. Catch me on Facebook, MC Todd. Tumblr, MC Todd with 6 D's. Yo, find me on the internet, man. If you want to put my shit out, I got like endless raps, man. I got rap game forever, man. All on my garage band.
I saw on Instagram that you have an official photographer.
For me?
Yes.
I do. Yeah.
What?
It's the...
Shout him out.
It's MC Togrifer. Or I believe it's the Mictographer. It's my boy. He's like, you know, he likes to follow me around, take pictures of me, and put it up on Instagram. You can follow Brandon Todd Hoy, too, which is my real person, which is me, which is Bravo Tango. Bravo Tango Hotel. Find me on Instagram.
Is there going to be
a
point where there is no Brandon Hoy or MC Todd, just one person?
I feel like my girlfriend would be really mad if that point came. She would be like, I don't know if I could have you at the strip club all the time. Like, I got to share, you know, I got boundaries.
So Brandon,
I'm an old dude, and it's not like I'm a young man, you know what I'm saying? It's not yeah. like I'm out into the world just like putting my dick in everything.
I would hope not, especially not.
I'm not.
Especially
baby, don't look at me like that. Definitely not at pumps.
No.
Anymore.
All right, well, let's I would say, what, you got one more song for us?
Yeah, you want to do one more?
Yeah, we'll just do one more. And so we got all the
information. We could do two. I could try one. I just don't know the words to my songs very well, because, you know, I got other shit to do in my life than like try to memorize stupid ass words to
all right
stupid-ass
let's
songs.
Do one song, and we'll come back, and then we'll close out with one more.
All right, cool.
All right, what's
like
this next
that.
One
this is just called Interlude. It's just straight rap, some boom bap.
Okay, all right, here we go. MC Todd live on Snacky Tunes, Interlude.
Fly chick buffet, oh shit, yes please. Knocking jaw, sweet lips, working bruised knees. Cinderella, Barbarella, top notch, Louis V. Slid the sweet lips out them sour panties. You know what I mean, short sweatpants, cut low around my knees. I make the girlies scream, I make that pussy stop, then I make that pussy pop. I make that pussy pop till that pussy don't stop, don't stop, don't stop, don't stop. I rock T-tops and Thunderbirds, J-5s with no socks. Hot bottom women that can handle this cock. These nerds always mad cause I'm always on top. Send them to the bottom like a Mutombo block. I'm full court pressing them. It's a lesson in how I always win and how I get the best of them. Life's a bitch, you best to start the wrestling. I be Jake the Snake Roberts proper. My pants on your breast, I'm the best when I chop ya.
Just oh, like man. An interlude, you know what I'm saying?
I like
just
that.
Breathing hotness.
For a white guy from the suburbs of Philly who knows nothing about rap, that sounds like a lot of like Wu-Tang to me.
Thanks, man. That's real.
Yeah.
Nope. I would have never thought.
I don't know
from
much.
From a white dude from Napa.
Yeah. Well, I believe in you.
Thank you.
And
I'm out here on the path trying to make people believe, you know what I'm saying? That's why I'm doing radio shows.
You know what it is?
And like, I'm on the internet.
It's, especially in Williamsburg, Bushwick, this area, there's not a lot of people who see things through. Like, the fact that you're actually going to put out an album.
I'm a doer, man.
And you're going to come out on radio shows and rap and do live stuff. That's, you know, and you played this summer.
Yeah, I'm playing. I'm playing a show.
Where are you playing?
I'm playing a show on Super Bowl. I'm playing halftime Super Bowl at Santos Party House with Andrew WK and Alistair X.
Oh, like, that's a real show.
Just like, but I'm playing like I'm doing like one song. You know, it's like a half hour set with Andrew WK. All right. And
most rappers only do five songs.
That's true. I only know two songs, so like that's like what I do. You know.
Well, it's good.
Thanks, man.
And it sounds good. It doesn't sound cheap. Thanks. It sounds real.
Well, because I spent money on it.
Yeah. But so few people cheap. See it through even that far.
Thanks.
Even bands. You know?
I agree. I'm a doer, man. You know, like, remember when you motherfuckers were like, you really go open a pizzeria? And everyone was like, oh, okay, dude, open a pizzeria. And then I opened a pizzeria. Boom, Roberta's.
Now I'm
the only Michelin star having motherfucking rapper in New York. I guarantee you that.
I guarantee you that. Look, I'll be the first to admit, but you got to understand.
But you know me.
I know you.
I've always done whatever I said I was going to do.
But you're talking like 6-7 years ago at like 5 or 6 in the morning when you're like, I'm going to open a pizza place.
When you don't believe anyone.
You don't believe anyone. Also,
cocaine, hell of a drug.
I wouldn't know anything about that.
I know.
I wouldn't know anything about that.
Mama.
I will say this, though. Brooklyn also wasn't the scene where what it was for food today.
It's true.
Like, if someone now told me, who was our age or like younger, there's like, oh, I'm going to open up a restaurant in Williamsburg.
But
like,
who's going to change the face of food? Like dudes like us, you know what I'm saying? We're just regular dudes. We weren't like, there was no pretense in this. We weren't like some dudes who thought we knew more than everybody else. We were just some dudes that cared. And I think like, that's like a lost treasure that's out there. It's just like people that actually care about shit and they say, I'm going to do something. It's going to be dope. And then they do it and it's dope. And like people do shit because they want to be cool and because like people are looking at them and all this other shit, and it's like, it's not that hard, man. Make something awesome and people will respect you.
And I understand the restaurants are a business. I get that. No one's like, I want to open up a restaurant that's a failure that doesn't make any money. But I've met so many people now because of where food has moved into the pop culture that they're just like, oh, this area needed a French Vietnamese cafe type of thing. So that's why we opened it, because we already had our ramen spot or we already had our taco spot. And you go, oh, some people just don't give a fuck. They just want to make money. And that bums me out.
Yeah, man. I mean, I think that's like an unfortunate thing for like the modern generations, is they got to go make money and they got to do things that they don't necessarily believe in. It's like, you got to go out and like work a corporate shitty job for somebody, like making some bullshit that nobody cares about to like pay your rent in New York. And it's really difficult to actually be that person who's like, fuck all of you. Yeah. I'm going to do my own thing. I'm going to make this shit and like, I'm going to make money and make the thing that I love. And like,
and that's not saying that if you want to make that money and you want to have that corporate job, that's fine. But you got to do something on the side. You got to live.
Fulfill your dreams, man. Like,
you're only
like,
at that job 40 hours a week.
Come on, man.
Like, you got a whole lot of other time to go and make other projects.
Life isn't about making money, man. Like that's like secondary to like everything else. You know what I'm saying? You can't just like expect to be happy because you're making money.
By the way.
Like, do things that are cool and you'll be happy. You know?
Don't make money in this lifestyle.
There's very low margins in the restaurant game.
In the pizza rap game.
I mean, the pizza game's different, man. Like, that's like the wheelhouse of this business. Like, pizza and booze is really where all the money comes. But all the food that people like drool over coming here for Blancas, there's low margins on that shit. Like, you got to be really crafty and very like, have like a very high like business IQ to like understand that, like, how to make money doing that. You got to follow things diligently and like look at the numbers and be like, yo, man, this shit ain't working, this shit's working. And you're like really pinching like margin points every day. You're looking at shit and you're like, this doesn't work, this works, this doesn't work, this works, this, and like keep adjusting. It's crazy. And it's hard to make money.
It's
hard. You gotta own like a conglomerate, like restaurant group, like Mario Batali or like Danny Meyer. You gotta be like one of those dudes if you really want to like get rich off this shit.
Come out to Bushwick, start a pizza place, open up a fine dining place, have a successful catering
business.
Yo, why
you think I'm trying to get in the rap game? I'm trying to get on that quick money, son.
Yeah, are you applying your business knowledge of restaurants to the rap game?
You know.
If you could get Danny Meyer...
Yo, man, you should see how diligently I follow the numbers when I'm rapping, son.
We're not... We got to make a better margin on the song. These beats are cutting into our percentage.
For reals, man.
Yeah, just get Danny Myers or Mario Batali to come out and do a verse. There are no chef rappers that I know of.
There, well, you know, Action Bronson is actually a chef.
Oh, that's right,
rapper.
He is. And he raps all about food.
Yeah, he's got a lot of food raps. Even Mayhem Loren, and Mayhem Loren too, which Respect the Fly Shit, which is like one of the best rap albums this year. I feel like it was really, really good. Like, take back to like the boom bap, and it like says, it speaks to like a type of person that like still needs to be speak to, that I feel like has gone unheard. Like, while there's all this like trap music and puss pop, like I feel like Bronson and Mayhem and like those kind of dudes are like, you know, reaching into a whole nother level of hip hop, you know.
Maybe you could treat those guys to dinner and they'll book you to open for them.
Hey man, if you're listening,
Action Bronson, if you're out there and you want to come on Snacky Tunes, we will buy you pizza for lunch.
Yeah man, lunchtime, dude.
I guarantee you like to eat pizza. I'm just saying,
for reals. I'm sure. I mean, who doesn't like to eat pizza? What are you, a dickhead?
Like,
you
know? I said,
like,
that's
what
probably...
fucking asshole doesn't like to eat pizza?
I would say the first year or two of how we were able to get people on the show was the promise of free pizza. Still to this day. Hemet and Hum, people go, like, look, we'll buy you Roberta's pizza. I go, oh, okay, I'll come out.
That's a good deal, I feel like. It's like...
You get to come out.
You got the drinks.
You get to drink, eat free pizza, and talk about whatever shit you're up to. Yeah, more beer. Oh, I want to try this one. What do we got? Pat, the gift that keeps the big IPA.
Hey, Joe, you think you can come in here and open this smutty IPA?
Yeah, we're going to have you crack this beer, and then we'll have you
it's
do one.
It's funny. So, like, just so you people out in Radio Land, I know you can't see, so they have, like, these really cool graphic labels on there, the smutty
old-timey
nose.
Labels.
And it's like a full photo print of, like, two old dudes sitting in front of a trailer. But, like, mysteriously,
Joe, why don't you crack one of those that's over there?
This dude's head off?
No, you take one. All right, I'll take one. Yeah. You're too nice, man. If I saw a six-pack of beer sitting there, I'd be like, I'd just open it. Cheers, buddy.
Joe's a very nice dude.
He is.
So this picture, it's like just the head is ripped off this one old dude. And it kind of looks like one creepy, like, Silence of the Lambs.
Just because the label. It looks like Bartle and James, sort of. Remember those dudes?
No, but see how the head is ripped off? It looks like some creepy, like...
That's just the label got ripped.
Nah, but I feel like some dude, some psychopath, like, was like, fuck, this old dude ripped his face off and then, like, you know, stared at it for a little while and then probably, like, killed some people. I don't know. You don't think that happened?
No. It's Monday.
Martin Luther King Day.
And we just swore in the new president.
Hey, we just swore in the new president on Martin Luther King Day.
You know who the last president was to get sworn in on Martin Luther King Day?
Ronald Reagan.
Bill Clinton.
Really?
Yeah.
That wasn't that long ago.
97.
So it's
every 12, I don't know.
Every 12 years somebody gets sworn in on MLK?
Actually, I think maybe. You know, I don't know. I got that fact from NPR this morning.
Yeah.
I didn't do any research.
What did NPR have to say about it? Do you feel like it's like Obama's overshadowing MLK?
No,
bit.
It was all parallels. It was all parallels.
They only link parallels. They don't want to be the ones to talk about shit like that.
No, they didn't. You know, they talked about the parallels about his struggle for race equality and how Obama's really doing like monetary and economic equality.
Right. Do you think he is? Do you think he's doing monetary? And come on.
I know.
There's no equality. Like, Martin Luther King did some really fucking amazing shit for equality, like, all over the United... Like, he was, like, really...
But he worked as an
change,
outsider. His hands weren't tied.
That's true.
Weren't tied.
Well, which I feel, to be honest with you, like, as a business person, I feel like once you, like, get inside that political realm, it's hard to actually make change. It's people on the outside that actually make that change. And people of power, like Jay-Z, could really, like, are the people that can actually, like, make change in the world. And like it's you have to understand when you have such a great power like that you can like really do amazing things, and like people look towards like Obama to be the one that's gonna like save us all, but it isn't. It's people from the outside that like can look in and say, I can change this with the power that I have.
I mean,
you know,
you look at it now that he's not trying to get reelected. He signed almost 24 executive orders about gun control. Would have never done that in the first term.
No, never. No way. He had
now,
to.
Now
he had to. Man, he like. Come on.
No, he
you
had
think,
to.
You think he's gonna let more kids like roll into schools and like blow people up? Man, that shit ain't cool. Like, I'm a like full gun advocate. Totally. I'm not gonna lie. How is he, his hands are tied, man. You can't like expect a dude to like have to like endure that politically to be like, I'm not going to be the one that's responsible for all this bloodshed. Like, I have to do something. Like, regardless if he really thinks it's right, he understands that he's put in a position where he's going to have to like make things better. And like, you know, it's a choice of like, you got to start prioritizing shit. You know what I'm saying? And like, I don't know, man. It's kind of a fucked up position because I don't know if he would have like regularly made that decision.
He wouldn't
have.
He wouldn't have.
And it's like, it's kind of fucked up.
But that's how it is now. I mean, that's why he's not going to change the world. And that's why.
I mean, no president's going to change the world. Don't let that shit's bullshit. Whoever's fucking sitting around thinking the president's going to change the world for him on some bullshit. For real. It's like. Change comes from the outside, man. It's a revolutionary perspective from people on the outside that look at our system and they say the system's fucked up and they change it. That's when change happens. When people from the outside that are smart and willing and have the balls like actually insert their will into the way that we do things and change it. From the inside, once you get on the inside, man, you just follow the lava. It's just like you just keep going down and you keep doing the same shit that everyone else does.
Yeah.
Burning the same hole down the whole world, just like, you know, creating the crevices. But like from the outside, you can look at it and you can be like, yo, that shit's fucked up, man. And you can step in, fucking put a dam down, change the stream of the lava and like make it into something else. That was a really weird analogy, man.
I get it, though. That's what you do with the rap game and the pizza game. Well, look, I've said it before, I say it again. It's always a pleasure to have you on.
Word.
And even I want to go on the record saying that when I tell people about the type of restaurant that I'm looking for in any other city, I'm like, you ever hear of Roberta's? I want a restaurant like that.
That's cool, man. Thanks, man.
And it really is.
I appreciate it.
And I say it every week. If you've never been out here, it's something special. And I'm happy to be part of the club.
Thanks, man.
We got one more song?
Yeah, man. Trape.
All right, we got Trape.
I'm going to rap over myself rapping because I don't think I know the words to this song.
Well, give us one more shout-out.
This is also got my man Ol' Weeby and David Lumberguts, who used to be my intern, but I fired him. But then I rehired him as a rapper on my rap album.
That's a true rag-to-riches story.
Yeah, man. He's a bum.
Give us the Twitter handle one more time.
It's the real MC Todd, because I don't want you fucking with the fake MC Todd. He's like a bar mitzvah DJ.
No, he's not.
Yeah, he
is. Are you serious?
Hey. It's cool. He's Jewish too. Don't
it's cool.
Worry. I ain't being an anti-Semite here. I'm just saying.
For a little bit of time, Greg and I tried to get into the New York Bar Mitzvah DJ scene.
You guys would have killed it.
Oh my God.
Killed it.
It's so.
You're like the
awesome.
Kardashians hiring like Tega.
Yeah, exactly. And next show is when?
I'm playing on Super Bowl Sunday, man, with Andrew WK and Alistair X.
And the album drops?
The album drops February 12th.
Where can
it's
you get
called,
it?
It's called Damn Near 40 Years in the Making, because it's taken me a long ass time to make a rap album. And you can get it on Bandcamp for free and Spotify for free and hopefully iTunes for free if iTunes will let me give it away for free.
That's awesome. And then you'll play more shows. Things like that. All right. Here we go. MC Todd. I'm Darin Bresnitz. We're back next week
Boom.
With more guests eating pizza. Shout out to everybody in D.C. having a good time.
Boom.
All right. Here we go.
Yeah.
Tonka slip, chewing on some dip. Huge mouth of chow, man, make me fucking spit shit. Tight fucking pants, big fucking hood ass. Reach into my pockets, man, find my bag of goodies. Head of app gooey, blue dream, I roll that chew at. Got me looking goofy, eyes closed, all droopy. Head of app gooey, blue dream, I roll that chew at. Head of app gooey, blue dream, I roll that chew at. Soaking up the rays, about to get paid. Set up in the back, sipping bourbon lemonade. All these skinny bitches trying to get that cocaine. Trying to get that whole thing, trying to lift that tie. Hold up.
Oh, we be in the corner, showing up. Acting creepy like a corner, looking sleepy, smoked up.
Real high, real high, real high. Yikes.
Don't tell your mom, man.
I done lost my mind.
I look like a bum.
in fancy shoes. Janet Costa jersey, man. Extra loose. Catch me
on the do.
I'm new news. Catch me in the post. A real douche. All flirt close. Snob a hoe from head to toe. Exploiting this fucking garbage man to make my fucking dough. Empty out my pocket. Nothing but lint. Time to come up, man. Flip the fucking script. Pendleton bags. Filled up like a crib. A bunch of gold shit. Takata sweatsuit. Looking mint. Color of peppermint. In the hotel getting bent. High as a fucking blunt. Acid and some scripts. Multiple dimensional. You got yourself a glimpse.
I'm into mix and match. I'm into buy and smash. I'm into pregnant women looking like they giving ass. I'm into sleeping long, cocaine and Xanax. I'm into busting white, brand new hand cast. I got them handbags, bootleg shit that cost less. I'm into fake titties, bitches that be topless.
I got that Betty White, I got that Charlie Sheen.
I got them Molly drips and everything that's in between.
I'm David Lumberguts, from the undercuts. Hairy lumber nuts, busting on you bumper clubs.
I'm the rapping Sherlock Holmes, turning mysteries to poems. I'm the man behind the curtain, cutting pizza like a sponge. Got these bitches extra virgin, hella white like Tide detergent. Moving in like night insurgents.
Smoking like a duchess, butter eyes like crusted.
Scrumptious and seductive, bitches get abducted.
And they fucking love it.
Rolling all by myself.
Drop top one, looking good. Lumber guts has got that wood. Good grain, sticky icky. Riding dirty, getting filthy. All these women out there tricking. Always driving, always drinking.
Oh, we be in the corner, showing up. Acting creepy like a corner, looking sleepy, smoked up.
Yeah, I'm real hot, real hot, real hot. Yikes. Think I done lost my mind. Think I done lost my mind.
Thanks for listening to this program on heritageradionetwork.org. You can find all of our archived programs on our website or as podcasts in the iTunes store by searching Heritage Radio Network. You can like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at @heritage_radio. You can email us questions at any time at info@heritageradionetwork.org. Heritage Radio Network is a nonprofit organization. To donate and become a member, visit our website today. Thanks for listening.